The ticket to have is to Memorial Stadium. Saturday afternoons are always special here in Lincoln, and today it's Senior Day. Moments ago, PA announcer Patrick Combs taking over.
And here are your 2012 Nebraska Cornhusker seniors. A safety from Norrock, California, number 3, Damian Stafford. A safety from River Ridge, Louisiana, number 13, P.J. Smith. A running back from Plano, Texas, number 22, Rex Burkhead. A tight end from Shawnee, Kansas, number 25, Kyler Reed. A defensive end from Huntington Beach, California, number 34, Cameron Meredith. A linebacker from Omaha, Nebraska, number 42, Sean Fisher. A linebacker from Madisonville, Texas, number 45, Alonzo Whaley. A defensive end from Moreno Valley, California, number 46, Eric Martin. A linebacker from Bon Terre, Missouri, number 51, Will Compton. A defensive tackle from Lincoln, Nebraska, number 55, Baker Steinkuhler. An offensive lineman from Lincoln, Nebraska, number 77, Sun Hoon Choi. A tight end from Ames, Iowa, number 81, Ben Cotton. And a punter and kicker from Kearney, Nebraska, number 96, Brett Maher. Husker fans, let's hear it once again for your 2012 Nebraska Husker football seniors.
This game is oh so important. Senior Day here at Memorial Stadium. 29 different seniors being honored. But quite frankly, Nebraska Rack, they can't afford to let emotion be a part of this game.
Yeah, it needs to be business as usual for the Cornhuskers today. A win against Minnesota here at home and a win next week on the road against Iowa. They will be playing in the Big Ten Championship against the Wisconsin Badgers. And for the Minnesota Gophers, don't think that they're going to be content with 6 wins. With every victory they get, that betters their position for the postseason game.
Now, before we get you ready for this game, we should mention we have breaking news in regards to the backfield for Nebraska.
Yeah, Bo Pelini telling our John Jansen that Rex Burkhead is doubtful for the game today. So it'll be, again, be business as usual for the Cornhuskers in the backfield as Amir Abdullah will again get the start. 6 games over 100 yards rushing this year, including the last 4. And Eric, he's averaging over 5 yards a carry. So if my math is right, give him the ball twice, it's a couple of first downs.
All right, Rack, what are your peak performance keys to victory?
Start with the Minnesota Gophers. I think it's the same game plan as it was last week against the Illini. They have to run the football and run it well. Donnell Kirkwood had a career high 152 yards rushing, and he'll be spelled by Roderick Williams. When you look at the Nebraska Cornhuskers, I think it's really important that they keep ball security at the top of their minds. They've had at least 2 turnovers in 9 football games this year. That's going to be the way that they'll let Minnesota back into this ball game if they give them extra opportunities on offense.
All right, let's kick this one off. Senior Day here in Lincoln, Nebraska's 29 seniors looking for a special senior moment, trying to close out their Memorial Stadium careers with a win. It's Minnesota taking on Nebraska. We have got the kickoff coming up in just a moment. Memorial Stadium, such a special experience. each and every time. Bo Pelini and the Nebraska Cornhuskers take to the field here at Memorial Stadium, getting ready for Minnesota and Nebraska. Nebraska trying to run their record to a perfect 7-0 here at home. Another sellout crowd here at Memorial Stadium. Third member of our crew, John Jansen, he is standing by with today's sideline report brought to you by Best Buy. John.
Hey, thanks a lot, guys. The wind is going to be an issue today. It's coming directly out of the south, but when it hits the stadium, it's swirling around. Minnesota's going to try and keep that ball on the ground. They're working on their sixth offensive line combination. We'll see how that pans out for them today. Communication's the key. Their center, the third center that they've had this year, and Zach Epping, he's going to have to really communicate to those guys what's going on. Back up to you.
John, thank you so much. His hair still perfectly in place, but we're expecting wind gusts up to 28 miles per hour. It's pretty consistent right now at 22 miles per hour, but the gusts could be significant. Ball's on the tee, and we're getting ready to play some football. Second time in as many years that Minnesota playing against Nebraska. Last year, Nebraska winning in Minneapolis at TCF Bank Stadium. Jordan Wettstein's going to kick it off. Deep into the end zone and through the back of the end zone. So it'll be a touchback. The ball will be spotted at the 25-yard line. Familiar face, junior Taylor Martinez, going to lead this Cornhusker offense out. This is start number 36 for Martinez in his college career.
Eric, you look at his season this year, and if you take away the turnovers that he's had between the interceptions, and the fumbles, he's had a really good year, especially what he's bringing to Nebraska as far as the running game goes. And as of late, with him and Amir Abdullah, has really been an unstoppable tandem.
No Rex Burkhead to start the game. Amir Abdullah, the eye back, and they pitch it out to him. Here's Abdullah. Picks up 4 yards, tackled by Aaron Hill. Take a look at our K. Jewelers starting offense. Three seniors in Quali, Choi, and Jackson. Jackson, a great story, was a defensive lineman before being converted to offense during the spring game, and he's had a solid senior season, starting every game as the center. Pitch and catch, Kenny Bell, his first touch, and he's got a first down for Nebraska. Refusing to go down, gets out to the 38-yard line. Let's take a look at the rest of the Nebraska Cornhusker offense. Amir Abdullah has been a real revelation. 6 100-yard games so far this year. In his first real starting experience with the Cornhuskers, just a sophomore out of Homewood, Alabama. So fresh set of downs. Martinez fakes the handoff, gets it out in space. Jamal Turner, room run, and Turner across the 50 skips out of bounds at about the 45-yard line. There is a flag down on the field. We'll have to figure this one out.
After the play was over, personal foul. Defense, number 23, 15-yard penalty. First down.
So it's going to be a personal foul against Minnesota, and an extra 15 yards turns into a really big play.
Yeah, coming to playing on the road, just can't afford to have those type of penalties. You really have to keep them at a minimum if you're going to have a chance to stay in a ball game, especially when you're going up such a talented offense like Nebraska's.
So Martinez has already thrown for 26 yards. That is significant. We'll tell you why in just a moment. First down and 10. Abdullah, another chance, and not much doing there. He is tripped up after a pickup of just 2. Here's today's Auto Owners Insurance starting defense for Minnesota. Rashid Hegman has been a real force, 6'6", 301 pounds. He is a local from a high school right in downtown Minneapolis. Middle linebacker Mike Rawlins has had a solid senior season. He's the one who calls out all the defensive signals. And in the secondary, a couple good safeties, Derek Wells and Cedric Thompson. It's going to be important for those safeties to be involved in trying to stop the Big Ten's best rushing attack. Inside handoff. Abdullah again stonewalled close to the line of scrimmage. Mike Wallace got him. There are the linebackers that Mike Wallace leads. Wallace is going to get a spell for just a moment. Guys in the secondary, Derek Wells, couple interceptions, 8 passes broken up, 52 tackles. Hasn't practiced much lately because he's been banged up, but hasn't missed any starts so far this season. Third down and 8. Opening drive for Nebraska. Martinez continues his perfect afternoon, but it's going to be a little bit short of the first down marker, it appears. Jamal Turner with the grab. It's going to set up a fourth down and short, and it looks like the field goal unit's going to come on.
It's pretty good execution right there by the Minnesota defense. They brought an all-out blitz, bringing 7 players under pressure. Really puts that secondary on an island, but a nice job right there by Brock Vereen coming up and making the play short of the first down marker.
Now the reigning Big Ten Special Teams Player of the Week, Brett Maher, coming on. He's going to attempt a 39-yard field goal. Jace Dean is the holder. Low snap, great hold, and Maher, did he hook it? No, makes it through. So, opening drive results in 3 for the Nebraska Cornhuskers. Taylor Martinez was a perfect 3-for-3, and Nebraska is on the board. Brett Maher just barely squeezing it through. BTN Football is presented by John Deere, the all-new, all-powerful Gator RSX 850i. Welcome back, everyone. Memorial Stadium, Lincoln, Nebraska. Special day on a number of different levels, not just Senior Day, but it also is a day in which 81,000 Nebraska fans can say goodbye to one of the very special ones in the college football game. Tom Osborne. This will be the final game, at least home game, in which he is involved with the athletic department. This is his 500th game in an official role at Nebraska. Either as an assistant coach, as the head coach, or the athletic director. He is stepping down January 1 from his post. KJ May on this return for Minnesota. And May's got a lot of speed, barrels out across the 25 to the 29-yard line. Return of 27 yards. This was before the game. Tom Osborne right there. The red baseball cap following Bo Pelini. And in amongst the Cornhuskers. Still looks bright as he's leading the team out in the field.
Really nice tribute right there by the crowd. The thanks, Tom. Personally, I never got a chance to play against him, but I can tell you growing up and through my college days in the 90s, you always heard about Tom Osborne and the type of Nebraska teams that he was putting together dominating college football.
3-0 lead for Nebraska. This is our first look at true freshman quarterback Philip Nelson. He starts this Gopher offense with a nice run off tackle. Nelson can do that. Powers forward, picks up 9 yards.
Again, I think Philip Nelson's off to a really solid start this season. Maybe not statistically looking at the biggest numbers. I think the most impressive thing to me is the last few games, he hasn't thrown an interception, so he's not hurting his offense. He's giving them a chance to be successful, and you got a chance to see on that first down play. He also brings that running element to the table for Minnesota's offense.
5th start for Philip Nelson. This is Kirkwood. And Kirkwood is stopped. Great open field tackle, Ciante Evans. Take a look at our K Jewelers starting offense and a whole bunch of changes. Ed Olson and Tommy Olson, his brother, they haven't started in over a month apiece. They're back in the lineup. Zach Epping, one of 3 different centers to have started this year on that Gopher offensive line. In the backfield and with the receivers, difference maker as of late has been Donnell Kirkwood. Had over 150 yards last week in Champaign against Illinois. 3rd down and 1. Football, and it doesn't work. So it was 2nd down and 1, and on 2 consecutive plays, no gains for Donnell Kirkwood, and Minnesota's going to have to punt the football.
Yeah, Nebraska really loaded up the box on that play. They had 9 players within about 6 yards of the line of scrimmage, realizing that Minnesota was likely going to try to go power football to pick up the first down. Excellent job getting penetration up front by the defensive front and the linebackers.
Christian Eldred will attempt his 47th punt of the year. And a lefty boots it down the sideline, and it is fumbled out of bounds by Jamal Turner. No damage done. Timeout on the field. 47-yard punt. When we come back, we will see the Nebraska Cornhuskers back on offense. Welcome back, everyone. 9:45 remaining in the first quarter. Nebraska a field goal on their first opportunity with the football. With my partner Derek Rackley, I'm Eric Collins. Earlier today, Michigan a win over Iowa, one of the many games in conference, and you're always paying attention right there.
Yeah, just got to make sure you're staying up to date on all the scores from the Big Ten Conference. Some pretty good big games today. Michigan took care of business. Nebraska trying to take care of theirs this afternoon.
He's a big second screen guy, is Derek Rackley. And, well, the Twitterverse that's always buzzing about Big Ten football and BTN Connect is the place to join the conversation. You can see what fans and the media are saying. You can vote in our Twitter polls, track the stats, and you can find out who's trending in the conference today. It's all at btn.com/connect. How about this? We mentioned it a moment ago. Taylor Martinez, now the school record holder at Nebraska for passing yards. He passed Zach Taylor on that first drive. That play is waved off. There's a flag down right at the snap.
Illegal motion, offense, number 80, 5-yard penalty, repeat first down.
Kenny Bell called for the illegal motion, and so it's going to back up the Cornhuskers 5 yards. Rack, everyone knows how sensational Taylor Martinez has been in just 3 years, but the fact that he's moving up the passing list is probably opening up a couple of eyes. No one has ever passed for more yards in their Cornhusker career than Taylor Martinez now. Amir Abdullah, still the eye back, trying to get to the edge. He is brought down from behind. Keenan Cooper grabbed a part of that jersey and is able to bring him down after a pickup of 3.
That's what this Minnesota defense needs to do with Amir Abdullah. They need him going east to west. Now, granted, he's got some excellent top-end speed, but allowing him to go east and west will give the rest of the defense time to rally to come make the play.
Quick snap, Martinez looking for someone. Passes low. It's dug out of the dirt by Jamal Turner, who has the first down. That was kind of a slow developing play, but it results in 22 yards.
Yeah, give Taylor Martinez credit for sticking in there, because Michael Omefiela, number 98 for Minnesota, was in there and made a nice hit on him right at the end of the play. Watch Martinez look in the other direction, and he takes a hit, but at least he gets his ball out of his hands, and they end up moving the chains.
Quick pitch out. Toss sweep right side of Abdullah out across the 40-yard line. Expect to see a lot of that. The toss sweep has become a real staple in this offense under the direction of Tim Beck, the offensive coordinator.
It really has been a good play for American, especially when they get their offensive linemen, their athletic offensive linemen, pulling up around the corner. You get those guys with a full head of steam coming downhill, looking at a linebacker or a defensive back that's a mismatch. Abdullah just has the patience to wait for it to develop.
Two tight ends in the game. This time straight up the gut. Abdullah picks up a yard, maybe two. Aaron Hill on the stop. That'll be enough for the first down, so the chains will move for the Cornhuskers. This Minnesota team going up against the best running attack in the conference this year. Nebraska piling up 269 yards on the ground each game so far through their first 10 on average. Speed sweep left side. Braylon Hurd, his first touch, and that was an ankle tackle away from being a huge gain. 7 yards for Hurd.
And it was still a little bit of the read option as well, Eric. You saw Taylor Martinez trying to see how things developed in front of him between the offensive line and the defensive front. He still had the option to pull that football out, had the read turned out that direction, but yet a good read for him to hand the ball off to Hurd again. Another big first down play, as you see on the season, 7.1 yards per play on first down. That's not per run or per pass, that's per play. That's one of the major reasons why this offense has been so effective, because they get huge chunks on first down.
A little outright completed to Kenny Bell, who's pushed out of bounds. Pick up a 5 and another first down for Nebraska. Bo Pelini, now in his 5th season, known around the country as just being a wonderful defensive mind. But it's a lot easier being a defensive coach when you know you got an offense that is as explosive as the one Nebraska has. Abdullah, another quality gain on first down. Abdullah picks up 5 yards. It'll bring up second and 5.
Again, you can see the heavy dose of run game for Nebraska, and I would expect it to continue until Minnesota is able to stop them on first down. And when you say stop them, that means 3 yards or less. Just continue to see Nebraska run, and maybe short throws like we've seen so far early on from Taylor Martinez.
Martinez passing so far, a perfect 5 for 5. Looking for the deep ball, has a man wide open, it's caught! Kenny Bell, touchdown, Nebraska!
Just when we talked about Taylor Martinez going with short pass game, he drops back and takes a shot downfield, and Michael Carter ends up number 23 for Minnesota, is in bad position in coverage, and you saw Kenny Bell's wide open down the middle of the field. Excellent big play for Nebraska after they've been going run game and short passes for the first couple of drives. A nice job by Tim Beck dialing up a long play and executing.
And that throw, folks, was directly into this 20-mile-an-hour wind. Taylor Martinez fires it 36 yards over the middle, and Kenny Bell on the receiving end. It's a 10-0 lead for Nebraska. Welcome back, everyone. Memorial Stadium, what does it all mean? Take a look at the Legends Division already today. Michigan a winner. That means that Nebraska needs to win to keep pace. Of course, with their head-to-win over the Wolverines, they had that tiebreaker in their advantage.
Yeah, we were talking to Bo Pelini yesterday, and he actually said last week, and I'm sure it's going to be the same this week and next week, is that he's pulling for Michigan to win. He doesn't want his team to be able to back into the Big Ten championship game. He wants them to get there because they ended up winning football games and earned their way to Indianapolis.
Taylor Martinez, a perfect 6 for 6 so far. Wants to throw. Incomplete. Here's the first miscue. Jamal Turner can't reel it in. Second down at 10. Martinez with Abdullah in the backfield next to him. Again, a throw, trying to get Jamal Turner out in space, and Turner picks up 4 yards. It'll bring up third down. Let's take a look at today's Twitter poll. We ask you which player will have the most sacks today. D.O. Wilhite from Minnesota or Eric Martin for Nebraska, both coming into today's game with 7.5 sacks through 10 games. Already a 100-yard passing day for Taylor Martinez, and we're not even through the first quarter. Third down and 6. Martinez whips it out. Oh, dangerous pass. Actually hit the defender in the back. Brock Vereen, if he had hands on the back of the shoulder pads, could have had a pick 6.
You can see Taylor Martinez was looking down to the wide side of the field to these receivers. It looked like he was making a last-minute play call audible just with those two guys. And there might have been a little bit of miscommunication right there. And you see Brock Vereen, if he had got his head around just a little bit quicker, might have came up with an interception.
So that's what the Gophers needed, you'd assume. They finally are able to stop Nebraska. Rugby kick into the wind, and look at the leg, man. Inside the 20-yard line, Brett Maher, he doesn't know it's windy out here. He gets it all the way down to the 15-yard line, a 56-yard punt.
It's the end of the play. Kenny Bell get blocked in the back. You can see right afterwards, he gets up going to the officials saying, is that not a flag?
Tonight, it's a special presentation of The Journey as Big Ten Network gives you an all-access look at the teams you love. Don't miss The Journey, Big Ten Football 2012, brought to you by Best Buy. Tonight at 8:30 Eastern, 7:30 Central, only on BTN. True freshman quarterback Philip Nelson wants to throw, and Nelson completes it. It is Derek Engel out to the 31-yard line. Good to see Engel out there. He's missed the last couple of games with an injury.
Yeah, they're happy to have him back in the ballgame. And it's a nice job by Philip Nelson going through his progression. You can see him started to the left side of the formation, quickly looked to the middle, then came back to the right and found Engel coming across on a skinny post route.
First down picked up by Minnesota. A pickup of 17 yards. Nelson again wants to throw, and it's complete. He's got Devin Crawford Tufts. Derek, on paper, this would seem like a bad match. You got a true freshman quarterback in Philip Nelson throwing on a windy day against the best pass defense in the Big Ten.
And I would add on top of that a pass defense that likes the pressure, especially going against a young quarterback. So it does kind of work against Minnesota because Bo Pelini and his defensive coordinator John Papuchis would like to bring extra defenders, whether that comes from the slot or from the corner in the boundary, to make sure they have a stop in the run game.
No chance there for Kirkwood. He was met in the hole by Will Compton. Not too many guys meet Compton and get extra yards after there's contact.
You know, I watched some tape, especially the past few weeks on Nebraska, and Will Compton is a guy that always continues to show up. He's got excellent instincts, and he got the ability to get off blocks and come downhill. That's the sign of an excellent linebacker, is one that reads the play as it develops, and then especially when he sees run game, he attacks the line of scrimmage.
Closing in on the 1 minute mark of the first quarter, third down and three. Nelson may have been contact. Here comes the flag. Josh Mitchell was right in on the back of Isaac Frickte.
Pass interference. Defense number five. Ball is placed at the spot of the foul. Automatic first down.
I think this was a good call. Left-hand side of your screen. Josh Mitchell, you won't see it on that view right there, but the contact, there he goes. The contact ends up before the ball comes to the wide receiver. I think this was a good call by the officials. Contact came too early on Isaac Frickte.
Bo Pelini flat out telling us yesterday he doesn't mind the occasional pass interference. He wants his DBs to be aggressive, and for the most part, they have been this year. Misdirection there on the pass play, and they fire it back over the left side of the field. Devin Crawford Tufts has a first down catch, a pickup of 12 yards.
Yeah, Philip Nelson, a couple of options right there. Crawford Tufts, he also had Andre McDonald that was running the exact same route but coming to the opposite side of the formation. But you can see he comes back and he delivers this ball in the right spot. He throws it in front of Crawford Tufts. If that ball is a little bit behind, his receiver, Siante Evans, probably breaks it up.
On a windy day, Nelson is a perfect 5-for-5 throwing the football. Gophers across the 50 for the first time. Nelson over the top. Ball batted away. It was intended for John Rabe, but Knights defense played by the middle backer, Will Compton.
Yeah, we just talked about Will Compton and his instincts right there. If he doesn't make that play, could it end up being a really big play? Because Damian Stafford, number three, came down on a blitz. You can see that Compton is by himself. Right at the last second, he gets his arm up in the air, is able to break up the pass.
Hey, John, what's the latest with the wind down on the field?
I'm standing down in the south end zone right now, and it's blocked a little bit by the stadium. You get down to that north end zone right now where Minnesota's heading, it's starting to swirl around pretty good. They need to be careful with that ball in the air.
Little pitch forward. What was that? Ball is loose on the field. I thought that was forward. It is. It's incomplete. Philip Nelson may be a bit confused. Was trying to pitch it to Donnell Kirkwood. Didn't have an angle, and it's going to be called an incomplete forward pass.
Good break right there for Minnesota, because that easily could have been a turnover. One of the bad decisions, one of the few bad decisions you've seen from Philip Nelson. I think that's part of what the coaching staff is looking towards the field. When you get to an option route or an option play, you don't want to pitch it late, because usually your running back is thinking that the quarterback is going to run. You can see Kirkwood just started to peek up field, because a lot of times the running back's going to go try to get a block for the quarterback. They're not anticipating a pitch coming that late.
That's cornerback Andrew Green down on the field. Looked like he ran into his own man. He had a collision with the thigh of Will Compton.
So Green being looked at. And that ball is loose.
You're coached to go after it. And there are about four or five Cornhuskers diving for the loose football. And Green collided with Compton.
Right at the end of the play, you can see all the Cornhuskers in there trying to get after the ball. There is, like you mentioned, Eric, there's a lot of collision going on there.
So the clock is stopped, 10 seconds to play here in the first quarter. This could quite possibly be the final play that Minnesota has with the wind at their back here in the first half. Mohamed Cisse, number four, comes in as one of the corners replacing Andrew Green.
Again, third and long situation. Look for Nebraska to bring a little extra pressure, try to get some bodies in the face of Philip Nelson as he looks downfield.
Just a four-man rush. Nelson wants a bunch. Incomplete. Looking for Frickty. Josh Mitchell had him step for step.
Yeah, that's good coverage right there. Maybe if Philip Nelson airs that football out, maybe a little bit further in front of him, he'll have a shot. But you can see that Mitchell is step for step with Frickty right at the last second, the left arm coming down and making a play on the football.
That was wonderful. Ball skills there for Mitchell. So another opportunity for Christian Eldred to punt with the wind at the back. This is his second punt. He's averaging 45. His third punt, he's averaging 45. And this one is a shank. Didn't give much of an opportunity for the wind to help it out. And it's going to be spotted at the 26-yard line. So we have played one quarter here at Memorial Stadium. With just the 20-yard punt from Eldred, it's going to be decent starting field position for Nebraska. And they don't need many more breaks. Both Pelini's Cornhuskers already leading 10-0. Welcome back, everyone. Memorial Stadium. This is the 500th game that Tom Osborne has served Nebraska in official capacity. Assistant coach, head coach, athletic director. He is leaving his AD job January 1st. Amir Abdullah with that carry on first down, first play of our second quarter. He picks up 3 yards. With Derek Rackley, John Jansen, I'm Eric Collins. Glad to have you here on a windy afternoon in Lincoln. Taylor Martinez throwing for 100 yards on the nose in the first quarter. This one a toss to Abdullah, tackled by Aaron Hill, a pickup of 5.
Yeah, Eric, you're talking on their last drive about this toss sweep and how they'll continue to run that. And again, look at see the position that it's put them in on third down. They have 1 yard to go. So there's so much options that that gives your offensive coordinator, Tim Beck, on what type of plays you can dial up. Generally, you could just go quarterback sneak or give it to Abdullah coming downhill. This situation, they've got cross in the ball game, but it's much easier to continue to move the chains when you're giving yourselves such third and short situations.
Power back is in. It's Amani Cross, and Cross able to barrel forward and pick up the first down. Cross is starting to earn a little bit more playing time late in the year because of that body of his. 225 pounds, scored a couple of goal line touchdowns a week ago.
Yeah, 8 carries for 22 yards against Penn State, and he only had 4 carries for 20 yards in the first 5 Big Ten games, so they're finding different opportunities where they can use his body frame to help out the offense.
Fresh set of downs. Back in the game, this is Abdullah who skitters forward across the 40-yard line, picking up 5 yards. We thought that there was a chance we were going to see Rex Burkhead this afternoon. He's been dealing on and off all season long with a knee injury, and we were told that it was going to be his decision as to whether or not he played today, and this, everyone involved just deciding that probably next week would be a better opportunity than right now. Martinez, pass is complete, juggled and caught by Kenny Bell. Out close to the 50-yard line, 8 more yards for Nebraska.
Burkhead. This is when it all started. Opening week against Southern Mississippi, twisted the knee, and he really hasn't been right all season long. He's missed five complete games and parts of three others. But somehow, Nebraska has found a way to still lead the Big Ten in rushing yards. Oh, this is going to be a halfback pass, but it goes nowhere. Mike Rawlins sniffed it out, and Abdullah is tackled for a five-yard loss.
Yeah, and I have no problem with the play call. They've had so much success running the football early on in the ballgame. They're going to try to take a shot down the field, this time with their running back. But again, the pressure coming in by Mike Rawlins. Abdullah makes a good decision to just pull the football down. You'd rather take a negative yardage play and have a chance on second down than potentially throw an interception from a guy that's not used to reading defenses and throw the football a whole lot.
Abdullah was knocking on the door of 1,000 yards for the season. Just lost five. Play clock down to three. Martinez in trouble. Throws it away. It is incomplete. And we've got a flag down. It was Keenan Cooper on the coverage. This has got a chance to really bail out the Cornhuskers.
Pass interference. Defense, number 21. The ball is placed as a spot and foul. Automatic first down.
Yeah, it's Brock Vereen who was on the coverage, called for the penalty.
And Brock Vereen doesn't know what's going on in the backfield. Likely didn't have to make this type of a play. Again, the pressure coming on Taylor Martinez. You see Mike Rawlins. The ball wasn't going to be caught. If he just lays off and keeps that backside arm away from the receiver, likely does not get the penalty.
It's actually just a 3-yard penalty, but the big difference is it gives the first down to Nebraska. Abdullah, short gain, pickup of 3 yards. Abdullah's 5'9", 185 pounds, yet he shows big-time toughness. He carried the football 31 times a week ago against Penn State.
The coaching staff didn't really feel or realize that he had had so many carries last week, but you know, when you watch him in this game and you watch him on tape, the thing that I like about Abdullah is that he is always tearing to the line of scrimmage. It's not like he's feeling it out. He is always running full speed towards the line of scrimmage.
Designed quarterback run, and Martinez out to the 45-yard line. Alex Keith on the tackle. It's going to bring up third down and short.
We've seen such a heavy dose of the running backs early in the ball game, and we know Taylor Martinez has the ability to break off a big play in the run game at any point, so Minnesota's going to have to make sure they continually keep their eyes on him as well in the running game.
Pass is high, intended for Kenny Bell. Martinez throwing with the wind at his back, and it looked like maybe that pass had more steam on it than Bell thought it had.
I think Kenny Bell will tell you that that's a ball that needs to be caught. The experience, how many balls he's caught throughout his career, was a little bit high, but definitely catchable for Kenny Bell.
This may be a field goal opportunity. Huge wind at the back of Maher. He's also the punter, folks, but he's going to attempt a field goal. This is a bomb. A 62-yard field goal attempt, and a timeout is called. Bo Pelini is going to give his team the chance to think a little bit more about this. Do you really attempt a 62-yard field goal?
There's definitely an opportunity.
We'll have the answer for you when we come back. Quick timeout here at Memorial Stadium. Today's Heisman history is brought to you by Nissan. Nebraska, they've had three Heisman Trophy Award winners. First one 40 years ago. Johnny Rogers, 17 touchdowns, 2,000 yards. When he won Nebraska's first, then in 1983, Mike Rozier as a senior, just terrific. 29 touchdowns for Rozier before he started his pro career. And then Eric Crouch, the last Husker to win the award back in 2001. One of only three NCAA quarterbacks, 3,000 yards rushing and 4,000 yards passing. Taylor Martinez, also a special player. Just a junior, Martinez having a terrific year and a wonderful career. How about Amir Abdullah?
Abdullah across the 50, knocked out of bounds. What a nice gain on first down. Studemeyer stops him, but it's going to be a pickup of 18 yards.
Just excellent patience right there by Abdullah. Looked like he was going to be stopped in the backfield. As you can see, he just kind of waits for everything to sort itself out front. And then once he sees the hole, he explodes through it. And again, first down success for the Cornhuskers. You can see, big play again. Move the chains, fresh set of downs.
997 yards on the season for Abdullah. Out to Bell. And Bell pushed out of bounds at the 40-yard line. 5 yards for Kenny Bell. Talk about this being a veteran Nebraska team. A lot of skill position guys are not seniors. Taylor Martinez, a junior. Bell, a sophomore. Abdullah, just a sophomore. Martinez keeps it. He's immediately got the edge. He's got the first down before he's run out of bounds. Let's go down to the field. John, what's the latest?
Well, Taylor Martinez is doing a great job of reading the defense. Minnesota is trying not to stack the box and keep guys out on coverage, but as they kind of yo-yo those guys up in man and zone, Taylor Martinez is picking them apart with those quick screens out and then obviously that long touchdown pass to Kenny Bell.
You know, right now, Nebraska really a chance to open something up. Heading deep, Martinez, his pass is caught. Somehow, Kenny Bell able to keep his hands underneath it and make the grab. It's a 29-yard gain.
Yeah, really good catch, but the throw, again, was in a position where only Kenny Bell had an opportunity to be able to bring the football in. You could see Nebraska's picking and choosing their times to take shots down the field. Again, off of play action, gets the linebackers coming towards the line of scrimmage, but you can see that football was directed away from the defense, so only Kenny Bell was able to make a play on the football.
Already 6 catches, 94 yards, and a touchdown for Kenny Bell. The big back cross dives forward. Touchdown, Nebraska! Third touchdown in the last 2 weeks for the freshman cross. So the first touchdown for Nebraska with the wind at their back. Lead is 16 to nothing. Brett Maher, chance for the extra point. And it is good. Not much to disagree with so far for this Nebraska offense. Taylor Martinez has done his job. He has been terrific throwing the football on this windy day. This is the key play on the drive. A 29-yard pitch and catch. Kenny Bell sets up the touchdown by Amani Cross. It's a 17-0 lead for the Huskers. Through the years, Memorial Stadium, it has changed quite a bit. 1923 was the groundbreaking. This is what it looked like in 1930. Things started to change, adding an extra tier in the 50s and closing the end zones in the 70s and installing lights in 2006. And the change hasn't stopped anymore. It's still going on as we speak.
Adding more seats, and I don't think there's any doubt that there will be Nebraska fans filling that new section being built currently.
85,330 here this afternoon, the 325th consecutive sellout. Well, cable viewers expecting the Purdue-Illinois game on an extra football game channel should be receiving it shortly. Just wanted to pass along that information. Purdue and Illinois should be receiving it shortly. Rushing yards, it's been a whitewash. Nebraska all over Minnesota. Passing yards, the same thing. 142 yards. Ready for Nebraska, while Minnesota just still trying to figure things out. True freshman quarterback Philip Nelson on the run, throws into the wind. An amazing catch by Frickley, but they're going to say he's out of bounds. Only used the left hand to pull it in, but he was out of bounds when he made the grab.
Yeah, pass came a little bit late from Philip Nelson down the field. You can see that Isaac Frickte, when the ball came to him, he really just didn't have a shot to bring down the football inbounds. Maybe if Philip Nelson throws it a bit sooner, he's got a shot to bring it in.
That's close. That was almost catch of the year for Frickte. Kirkwood barrels forward and picks up a pair of yards. Ankara and Compton on the stop. Let's take another look. I thought this could have been looked at a little bit longer.
Right at the end, left hand.
Does he have the ball secure there?
Oof. Awfully close.
He was sliding with it, left foot.
Was dragging inbounds as it crossed into the white.
Nebraska hasn't allowed Minnesota to convert a third down so far. Gophers are 0-4 on third down conversions. Derek Engel is the man in motion. Nelson passes incomplete. He was looking for Engel. Would have been enough for the first down. Justin Blatchford on the coverage.
Derek, those are the plays that have to be made, especially when you're on the road facing a third and long situation. Engel was open. Just has to be more of an accurate pass by Philip Nelson. It's been delivered a little bit higher. Put it outside of the receiver. Let him run to it. Catch it even if he got tackled. He had enough. He was past the sticks. They would have been able to move the chains.
Eldred's been a busy man. This will be his fifth punt. The Gophers have had five drives. And on four separate occasions, Rack, they've gone three and out. Into the win, and Eldred almost made it back. It hit the Gopher at the 40-yard line. Not a great punt. Single digits. 7 yards on the boot from Eldred.
And, Eric, I'm a little confused because when he rolled out, he dropped the football with the nose down like a lot of punters do when they're trying to pin somebody inside the 20-yard line. Watch as he rolls left and he drops the nose to the ground. That's going to kick the end-over-end ball, which especially if you're going against the wind, it's just going to get hung up in the wind and it's going to end up coming backwards, whereas you need to drive it and try to get a spiral that turns over. Instead, we see the 7-yard punt gives Nebraska outstanding field position.
He was right there. He could have been the one to down his own punt. So great starting field position for Taylor Martinez in Nebraska. Ball at the 34-yard line. Quick pitch and catch. Out in space, Turner barrels forward. Down close to the 25-yard line. Once again, good first down yards for Nebraska.
Yeah, whether it comes in the run game or the pass game, but again, you're talking about a long throw from Martinez as far as Deason West, but not so much down the field. They've been able to be really successful in the pass game by throwing these throws that are right at the line of scrimmage, maybe 2 or 3 yards, and the receivers are making plays after the catch.
Abdullah looking for 1,000 yards on the season. He's going to lose a couple. Brock Vereen blows that up, gets into the backfield, and causes a loss of 5.
This is the type of pressure that Minnesota needs to get, especially when Nebraska is continuing to have such success in the run game. They have to get the offensive line pushed back in the backfield, allow the rest of the players, especially secondary, to come in and help make a tackle.
3rd and 7. Wind at the back of the Huskers. Martinez taking his time. 3-receiver formation. Much of a pass rush. Martinez, plenty of time, has a man, it is caught. Quincy Enunwa down to the 2-yard line. 30 yards and another big play for the Huskers.
Cover 2 by the Minnesota defense, and Michael Carter, number 23, again, was just trying to sink underneath this route. Had a shot to break it up, but it was a good thrown football by Taylor Martinez right over the top of Michael Carter and right in front of Derek Wells, number 13. You can see the concentration by Enunwa as he bobbled the football to be able to bring it in inside the 5-yard line.
2 tight end formation. The big fella cross lowers the head, and he's not going to get there. He's still not blown dead. Now it is. Folks, if you're wondering at home, for the first couple of years on campus, number 18 for Nebraska was Quincy Enunwa. but he just told the sports information people here at Nebraska 2 weeks ago. It's actually a noon one. So if you're wondering, it's a noon one now, no longer a none one.
So often we talk to the sports information directors. A lot of times the guys will let people mispronounce their name for a number of years.
There's no mispronouncing Imani Cross. He's going to be a household name pretty soon. Couple of touchdowns for the second straight week. And the lead is now 23-0 for Nebraska.
If I'm Imani Cross, I go to the sidelines and I congratulate Taylor Martinez and Quincy Anunua for the big play they had to get him inside the 5-yard line. And as we've seen over the past couple of weeks, Nebraska really likes to bring Cross and his body frame in there, as you talked about, Eric, 225 pounds, to be able to use his physicality to get into the end zone.
Maher, the extra point is good. Two touchdowns in the last 3 minutes and 25 seconds for Nebraska, and both of them virtually the exact same script. Big pass plays. Martinez getting it down inside the 5-yard line. This one a pass to Anunua. And then once again, Imani Cross barrels forward for 6. Welcome back, everyone. Memorial Stadium. Nebraska all over Minnesota in the second quarter. Coming up after the final drive later, it is the Big Ten Network original series that looks at legendary teams in the conference from those that lived it. Don't miss a special presentation of Big Ten Elite 1994 Nebraska, led by Chase Freedom. That's after the final drive, only on BTN. Been some great teams over the years in Nebraska football history. Kickoff is going to make it into the first row in the north end zone. Now this is a difficult little nugget for Minnesota fans to digest. Two wide receivers, Kenny Bell and Jamal Turner, both have more yards than Minnesota does as an entire team.
They're really struggling offensively here in the first half, and you have to continue to go out and execute, but it's getting to the point where Minnesota really needs to get points on the board if they want to try to make this game competitive. You can see that Nebraska's offense just really has not been slowed down throughout the ballgame.
Trying to get Roderick Williams to the edge, and Williams gets out to the 34-yard line. Bill Compton, he's been pretty busy so far this afternoon. True freshman quarterback out of Mankato, Minnesota, Philip Nelson, 19 years of age, making his fifth collegiate start. Play fake. Nelson gets the first down. Angling right towards that marker and picks up 3. And it'll be a first down for the Gophers. So small victories right now.
Yeah, really need to just take it step by step. We talk about all the 3 and outs that they've had throughout the first half. They just need to get a couple of first downs and keep the football moving down the field. And not only that, yes, they want to put points on the board, but they really need to give their defense a little bit of break to try to slow down Taylor Martinez and what these Cornhuskers have been doing on offense.
Across the 40. A.J. May was nicked up in last week's game against Illinois, but he was a full participant in practice all week long, and they like to get him involved just because he offers that speed element.
Yeah, that was a play that we saw last week against Illinois where he came across the formation, but they faked it to him every time. He actually did not get a carry, so you figured that was the next evolution of that play, was to go ahead and give it to him coming across. But it seemed like Nebraska sniffed it out because there was a lot of communication going in the secondary as soon as they saw K.J. May lined up in the slot coming across to motion.
Frickty, the man in motion, second down at 6. Designed quarterback run, fooled no one. Eric Martin, a senior playing his final home game, always an excitable man, makes a nice play.
Yeah, I really like watching Eric Martin on tape. He's got excellent hands as far as how he gets into the defender and disengages. You can see right there the swim move that he had against Lincoln Plishek, the tight end. That's going to be a mismatch for a guy like Eric Martin, an experienced defensive end, going against a young tight end in Plishek.
Under 2 minutes to play here in our first half. Gophers still haven't converted a third down. Here comes the blitz. Nelson notices, but it's too late. Ciante Evans brings him down. Nebraska just doesn't stop defensively.
One of the favorite pressures that Nebraska likes to bring is the corner blitz coming to the boundary field or the short side of the field. And Ciante Evans does an excellent job coming from the backside. Phillip Nelson sees it, just doesn't have enough time or quickness to be able to get away from Evans.
So now Nebraska calls a timeout. You saw what happened last time the Gophers tried to punt. It was a 7-yard punt. So they want Minnesota to punt into this wind and hopefully get some good field position with still 94 seconds remaining in the first half. Stay tuned at the half, everyone, for the Buffalo Wild Wings halftime report. Already today, nice road win. Northwestern heading to East Lansing. How about Michigan State? They did not win. A home conference game all season long. Eldred, this one a low kick. Takes a bounce at the 38-yard line. And it'll be downed at the 35. Punt of 35 yards into the wind for Eldred. Let's see what Taylor Martinez and the Cornhuskers can do with a minute 26 left to play here in the half. It's Jamal Turner down on the field. He was back to return the punt. Actually didn't touch it, but he's the one now down on the field.
The training staff working on that left calf. His, a lot of times when you see him have one foot on the shoe and the other one massaging out a muscle in the legs, cramps, usually the first thing that come to mind. Not so much in cooler conditions, but sometimes if the guys get dehydrated, they'll catch one of those cramps. Let's try to work one out on the field.
Taylor's had a big day. Taylor Martinez has been throwing beautiful passes with wind at his back and throwing into the wind. He's only had 3 incompletions, 179 first half yards.
That's really why Nebraska's offense has been so dynamic this year, because they've really had a pretty balanced offensive attack. We know that they can run the football even without Rex Burkhead in the ball game. They've got Amir Abdullah, and of course Taylor Martinez is quite the running threat as well. But did they have a consistent pass game that could be able to take advantage of when teams started to load up the box to slow down the run? And through the first half here, that's exactly what Taylor Martinez has been able to do. Hit a couple of long passes downfield and catch that Minnesota defense off guard.
Andrew Rodriguez has come in to play right tackle here in this series for Nebraska. No surprise there. He normally rotates in a couple of times throughout the course of games. Martinez to throw. Pass is complete. Once again, Inunua with the grab has a first down for the Huskers. Clock will stop temporarily. 1:17 to play here in the second quarter.
Again, accurate throw by Taylor Martinez, taking what the defense gives him. Minnesota drops back in zone. Receiver just stops up right in front of the defense, and Taylor Martinez throws an accurate football.
Another completed pass in Inunua. Goes out of bounds. That'll stop the clock. 1:06 left to play, and Inunua looks like there may be something amiss. Gain of 4. Inunua is now going to be replaced by number 21, Stephen Osborne, in at one of the wide receiver spots. Closing in on 200 yards passing for Nebraska. Martinez going to run, has the first down, stops the clock.
8-yard run for Martinez.
That's a situation right there. I'd ask Tracy Clays, Minnesota's defensive coordinator, about this week. How do you slow down Taylor Martinez as far as his running ability? He says when they do drop back to pass, our linebackers have to make sure that they don't get too deep in their coverage, because when Taylor Martinez sees a gap in the defense, that's when he'll tuck it down and be able to become such a threat running the football. Exactly the situation that unfolded. Minnesota got too far back on their drop.
Five-man rush. Martinez completes the pass. That's Kyler Reed, his first grab, 20th on the season. 11 more yards for the Huskers.
Again, encouraging for the coaching staff for Nebraska, seeing this offense really run an effective two-minute situation, which at some point this year they may need to win a football game in the fourth quarter when it's really close through a two-minute situation, especially with Taylor Martinez throwing the ball.
Martinez averaging 211 yards passing per game. He's already at 205 here in the second quarter. Inunua back in the game for Nebraska at one of the wide receiver spots. Throwing deep, miscommunication, and it is incomplete. Looking for Jamal Turner.
Yeah, I think Martinez felt like Turner was going to run a little bit skinnier post in that situation. And Brock Vereen ended up falling down as well. Had Brock Vereen not fallen down, he might have had an opportunity on the football, but you can see that Jamal Turner was nowhere in the vicinity to make a play on the ball.
Nebraska with two timeouts to work with. Again, Martinez jumps up in the pocket. The pass is incomplete. Martinez didn't know whether to run or pass, decides to throw it out, and Abdullah can't haul it in.
Again, still an accurate football from Taylor Martinez. Abdullah just looked like he started to peek upfield, try to make that next move before he secured the ball.
So it's third down and 10. Probably already in field goal range on a windy day for Maher, who's got a huge leg. Drive caught. Kyler Reed bobbled it, has enough for the first down. Clock stops, 33 seconds remaining in the second quarter.
Again, we've been talking about Taylor Martinez and how he's throwing the football, but you got to give credit to the offensive line. Look at how much time Martinez has had to be able to go through his progression and find an open receiver. That Cornhusker offensive line doing an excellent job of picking up the pressure and the stunts by Minnesota.
Martinez again looking to the end zone, incomplete. He was looking for Turner, and it'll bring up second down. Derek, you and I had a chance to watch these Cornhuskers in their walkthrough yesterday on this field. And Taylor Martinez, a lot of people say things about his throwing motion, but when it's underway, that ball's got a lot of revolution to it. He throws a tight, nice ball.
Yeah, he's got some zip on it, and he's got a really good spiral, especially if he is able to just slow himself down a hair to make sure that he gets his back foot into the ground and he steps into the football. He throws an accurate and fast ball.
Design rollout on the run, incomplete. And we've got flags down in the end zone. Studemeyer was on coverage. And this is going to be interesting. Is this going to go against the Gophers?
Pass interference, defense, number two, 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
Second time in this first half that the Gophers have been called for a costly pass interference.
Yeah, it looked like there was some contact a little early by Studemeyer right there. I like the fact that Taylor Martinez, when he's taking his shots down the field, he's making sure that he's throwing it to a location where the defense cannot make a play on the football. So either his receiver is going to catch it, or there are going to be some defensive pass interference by Minnesota. And that's what we got a chance to see on that last play.
9 seconds left in the first half. Martinez to the end zone. It is caught by Turner, but short of the end line. Michael Carter saved the touchdown. That's Kenny Bell with the grab. And it's going to force Nebraska to call a timeout, and I'd imagine kick a field goal.
Yeah, definitely kick a field goal in this situation. Just get points on the board. Kenny Bell actually comes in towards the middle of the formation, then he goes back out. And Michael Carter makes a good play in the open field to prevent the touchdown.
So Bell takes it to the 1 yard line, but he can't get in. Michael Carter keeps him out of the end zone, and it doesn't appear as if the field goal unit's going to come on for Nebraska. They're going to go for this. Do you agree with the call?
Well, again, you look at it, it's 24-0 right now. Nebraska clearly in control and wanting to make sure that they make a statement in the ballgame. So I don't really have a problem with it. I think maybe the more conservative viewpoint is just go ahead and kick the field goal, make sure you get the 3 points on the board, go up 27-0. But again, the offense for Nebraska has really been dominating, haven't been stopped much at all throughout the ballgame.
Now it's Minnesota's turn to call a timeout. Jerry Kill already has his Gophers bowl eligible. They picked up their sixth win a week ago. But this week was an important week to try and see where the program is on the road against a ranked, very good team in Nebraska. And right now, it's been a tough first half.
Definitely been a tough first half for them. And I think you could have anticipated this because the way that Nebraska has been playing, especially their defense, has really been coming into their own. And the offense has just found ways to continue to put up points, even when they found themselves trailing in a lot of ball games, especially in Big Ten Conference play. There's a lot of mental toughness by this team. They're always feeling like they're still in the ballgame.
Power formation. They give it to Cross. No signal yet. He didn't get there. The freshman, Amani Cross, is denied. Mike Wallace, the middle linebacker, came up and met him. And Bo Pelini's gamble, if you can call it a gamble, up 24-0, just doesn't work.
Minnesota clearly anticipating that they're going to go run play with Amani Cross in the ball game. So nice job by flying to the line of scrimmage. You can see all the Minnesota players with excellent pad level getting down low, and Mike Rollis coming up over the top to make the play on Cross, keeping him out of the end zone.
It was the combination of Keenan Cooper, who got the first hit on the running back Cross, and then it was Rollis who made the second hit and was strong enough to hang on and keep him out of the end zone. So maybe something small to build on for Minnesota. They were assaulted by Taylor Martinez, who was terrific through the air. 221 passing yards, leading to 3 touchdowns and a field goal. 24-0 is our score at the break. Stay tuned, everybody. At the half, coming up, the Buffalo Wild Wings halftime report. BTN football is brought to you by Auto Owners Insurance. In this moment, who has your back? Protect what matters most with an Auto Owners Insurance independent agent. Find yours at AutoOwnersInsurance.com. Well, Saturday, November 17th, such a special day here at Memorial Stadium in Lincoln, Nebraska. Not just Senior Day, with the Cornhuskers saying goodbye to 29 seniors, but also the final game in an official capacity at Nebraska for Tom Osborne. And it's just a coincidence, but it's a big round number. 500 games that he has been involved with this North Nebraska Cornhusker football program. It started back in 1962 as an assistant coach. Spent 11 years as an assistant. Took over as the head man in 1973 all the way to 1997. That encompassed 255 wins. And then, of course, most recently as the athletic director, taking Northwestern from the Big 12, or taking Nebraska, sorry about that, from the Big 12 to the Big 10. And this is going to be it for him here at Memorial Stadium. He plans on retiring January 1st.
It's really been special, too, especially during the halftime ceremony here. They ran a number of tributes on their video board here at Memorial Stadium. Every time one of those started, it was completely silent. 85,000 people in here. Everybody was quiet to listen to what all the folks that had such an impact on Tom Osborne's life and vice versa had to say about the former coach and AD.
Rivals Barry Switzer, Bill Snyder, Big Ten Commissioner Jim Delaney, even Supreme Court Justice Clarence Thomas, all with video tributes here at Memorial Stadium. All right, our third quarter is underway. Let's take a look at our 5-hour energy first half stats.
Such domination by Nebraska, 306 total yards to 60 for Minnesota. And look at the rushing column for the Gophers. That's where they've been so good, especially in their wins this year, as they've ran the football well. 11 carries for 10 yards so far in the first half. They'll have to find a way to be able to run the football, which will allow Philip Nelson to be able to find some holes in the passing game when they do decide to throw.
Nelson, the true freshman quarterback, playing in front of 85,330. Donnell Kirkwood on the ground. This is the guy who ran for 152 yards just a week ago against Illinois. In the first half, he had a grand total of 3 net yards.
Again, shuffling on the offensive line for Minnesota, but again, give credit to the defensive front and the linebackers for Nebraska. They've found a way to create havoc up front and really haven't opened any holes, or any holes haven't opened up for Minnesota when they have decided to go run game.
That was the longest rush on the day for Kirkwood. Previously had been a gain of 2. Picks up 3 there. Second and 7. Designed quarterback run. And Nelson uses the big body to fall forward to the 29-yard line. Wind continues to be a factor here at Memorial Stadium. It's been fairly consistent with 22-mile-an-hour winds, sometimes gusts of more than that. Wind is coming from the south end zone to the north. So right now, Minnesota is heading into the wind. Third and 6. Incomplete slant route. And once again, great defense played. Andrew Green able to get the right hand in and knock away the pass.
And the timing for these Nebraska corners has been really good throughout the ball game. When Minnesota has decided to throw outside of the one pass interference penalty, Nebraska has timed up the breaks on the football extremely well. You can see that Andrew Green, right at the last second, reaches his right arm, his backside arm around, to break away the football and cause the fourth down for the Gophers.
Fifth 3 and out forced by the Nebraska defense. Eldred into the wind. Turner with the catch at the 35-yard line, spins out to the 40. We'll keep it here as Nebraska has their first second half possessions. Take a look at the Quicken Loans quarterback comparison.
And no surprises how lopsided it is. Again, Taylor Martinez, 74% completions in the first half, throwing 23 passes, and may not have thought that they would throw the football that much, as much success as they've had running. But when you have a quarterback that comes out and shows in the first two quarters that he's really feeling it, he's having a good day, he's feeling accurate with the football, you continue to dial up, especially a lot of those throws have been going towards the line of scrimmage and just quick screen passes.
On the ground, Martinez keeps it, skips over a defender, there's a flag down. Martinez all the way inside the 25 before he is brought down by Derek Wells. Flag thrown right at the line of scrimmage. It would be a pickup of 35, but it appears to be coming back.
Offense, number 61, 10-yard penalty. It remains first down.
So it does indeed go against Nebraska. And a 35-yard gain is nullified.
Now Spencer Long, number 61, is their right guard. He's climbing up to the second level. He's the one to end up being guilty for the holding penalty.
So it's a loss of 5. Gain was 5 before the hold was called, and so from there you spot the penalty. So it's really a loss of 5. First and 15. Ball now at the 35-yard line. Again, Martinez keeps it, nothing there. Tackled right at the line of scrimmage, maybe picks up a yard. Rack Nebraska leads the Big Ten in rushing yards per game. As you see Taylor Martinez, what he's done. Freshman, sophomore, and junior year all setting single-season records for total yards at Nebraska. This year, he is leading the Cornhuskers to a Big Ten high, 269 rushing yards per game. They didn't dominate on the ground in the first half. They'll probably try and figure that out here in the second.
Yeah, you'd like to think that they're going to go with a little bit more run game here in the second half, especially maybe with Taylor Martinez running the football a little bit more than he did in the first 30 minutes.
And as we say it, there's a deep throw down the right sideline intended for Kenny Bell. Had no chance as the pass sails out of bounds.
You know, we talked about the first down success for Nebraska in the first half, and you can see they didn't have too many of these third and 15 situations in the first half. Now they've backed themselves up with the penalty. Be interesting to see if Nebraska is able to keep themselves out of these third and long situations throughout the second half.
Four-man rush for the Gophers. Caught. Turner. He's got the ball in the first down. How do you get that open on a third down at 15?
But again, it was really good protection by his offensive line, and that was just really good quarterback play by Martinez. He gets back in the pocket. He's got time to step up. And again, when he steps into his throws, we talked about in the first half how accurate and how well he throws the ball. Sometimes he'll get a little bit lazier. When he gets under pressure, he'll try to throw it off his back foot, and that's when he just doesn't have the same kind of zip on the ball.
Six catches now for Jamal Turner. He is knocking on the door of 100 yards receiving. Another pass play. Martinez throws up the back foot. It is incomplete. And Nunwa can't hang on.
That's one of those throws he'll have to be careful with. A double clutch trying to throw in the soft spot of the cover, too. When you do that, you're giving that safety time. You see Brock Vereen coming across to make a play. Had that ball been a little lower thrown by Martinez, Vereen could have made a play on it. You have to be careful trying to throw that ball late against cover, too.
Vereen was slow to get up, and he'll have to go to the sideline for a play. Cedric Thompson replaces him. Thompson normally one of the safeties. Let's go down to the field. John Jansen, what's going on?
Yeah, we got a chance to talk to Tim Becker, offensive coordinator, yesterday, and we asked him about Taylor Martinez's growth as a quarterback. He likes the fact that he's managing the offense, not just running plays. He's controlling the tempo, using his eyes to look off receivers, which we've seen today.
Completed a third and 15 a couple of moments ago to keep this drive alive. Now Abdullah loses the football. Gophers say they have it, and they do. First turnover of the game, and it's going to be Minnesota Golden Gopher football, just what they needed.
Yeah, again, you go back to the beginning of the game. What did Minnesota need as far as coming on the road, facing a pretty hot Nebraska team? Well, they needed to be able to take advantage of turnovers. That just didn't happen in the first half. What we're seeing here, the first drive for Nebraska, cough up the football and give Minnesota an opportunity to come out. It doesn't look like he got hit very hard. Maybe he just lost track of the football. But James Manuel was the one that was able to cover it up.
I think it was Eric Jacques who got the football out, kind of swatted at it. That's who Abdullah ran into. And Manuel does indeed recover the ball. So an opportunity for Minnesota. They had a three and out just a moment ago. KJ May in motion. Nelson wants a bunch. It is intercepted. Huskers get it right back. Damian Stafford with the pick. Turnovers on two straight plays.
They had it. Andre McDonald made an excellent break as far as adjusting back to the football. And all he has to do is make the catch. Instead, it bounces off of his hands and shoulder pads right into the hands of Damian Stafford.
Welcome back, everyone. Just a moment ago, Philip Nelson turning the ball over for the first time.
And Andre McDonald, excellent adjustment right here. The ball was underthrown by Philip Nelson. Just got to bring it in. Got to make the catch. But an excellent job of staying in the play by Damian Stafford. Sees the ball bounce off of McDonald and gets the turnover right after Nebraska had coughed it up.
Third interception for Damian Stafford. We've gone 78 plays in this game without a turnover, and then turnovers on back-to-back plays. Amir Abdullah tackled right at the line of scrimmage. D.L. Wilhite with the stop.
Second down and 10.
Nelson been really effective as far as throwing the football, not hurting his offense by throwing interceptions. You can see that was the first one in the last 82 attempts. He had two in his first game starting against Wisconsin, had not thrown one since that point.
Martinez keeps it, not able to spin out of the tackle. James Manuel brings him down. Ball comes out late, but the play was whistled dead. It's going to bring up third down and long.
I think that was a good decision, even though it ended up being a negative or zero yardage play. Well, D.L. Wilhite was in the backfield. Had Taylor Martinez handed that off to Abdullah, he would have been tackled in the backfield. He made the right decision. That's just good defensive play by the Gophers.
Cornhuskers 4-for-7 on third down. They need a bunch here. Third down at 10. Just a three-man rush. Martinez steps up, has a man, and it's caught in Numa. Second time in this third quarter, a third and 10 or more has been converted by Martinez on a pass play.
And it's, again, it's the effect of Taylor Martinez and what he does to a defense as far as a threat of running the football. You can see when he steps up into the pocket, Minnesota thinks that he's going to run. The guys step up, the coverage falls down in the back end, and Anunua was there to make the play.
Just a three-man rush, and Anunua was that open that he picks up 21 yards. Here's Abdullah. He's gone over 1,000 yards on the season. His best gain of the afternoon. He picks up 23.
Talked a little bit about it in the first half. One of the things that's just so impressive when you watch Abdullah run the football is how he attacks the line of scrimmage. So many players will end up trying to feel their way through the hole. That's not the case with Abdullah, as you can see what he's done for Nebraska, going over 1,000 yards. Again, not even planned to be the starter this year. Rex Burkhead was going to be the player. That's the depth that they have at the running back position.
Out in space, Kenny Bell, his 8th catch, and he's got a chance. Down the sideline, touchdown, Nebraska! Second touchdown of the game, Taylor Martinez to Kenny Bell. The big play guy continues to be the big play guy. 8 touchdowns now on the year. You just saw it. All of them at least 25 yards or more.
Nebraska's not doing anything different offensively than they did the first half. Again, just give credit to the receivers making a play after the catch. Minnesota not able to rally to make a tackle on Kenny Bell.
30-yard touchdown, Martinez to Bell. And how about this for a big play offense? Nebraska, 3 straight plays of 20 yards or more, covering 74 yards. They're up 31-0. Much history here at Nebraska. National championships in 1970, 1971, 94, 95, 1997. 43 conference championships. This year, the big goal, at least first, is winning the Legends Division, something that they have never done. Now the second year that the Cornhuskers in the Big Ten. Cornhuskers control their destiny, a win today, and if they win next week against Iowa, no one can stop them going to Indianapolis and playing in the Big Ten championship game. Wind at the back of Maher, and he kicks it through the end zone. Take a look at the standings in the Big Ten. This is just the Legends Division. Michigan a win earlier today. They're temporarily a half game ahead of Nebraska. But remember, Nebraska owns the tiebreaker should Michigan and Nebraska finish tied.
It's just tough to think that Nebraska is going to lose a game, obviously, in control of this one. Then they go to Iowa, which can be a tough place to play. Iowa's not playing its best football, but you just look at the product on the field for the Cornhuskers, and it's just one that, as long as they don't turn the football over and have too many penalties, it's just going to be hard to stop the way that they've got things running, rolling offensively, putting a lot of points on their board, and their defense has really come into their own.
Roderick Williams, full head of steam, gets out to the 35-yard line. This is what it's going to look like. Michigan beating Iowa handily today. They've got Ohio State next week. That game's going to be in Columbus. Nebraska, the much easier road. They're going to go on the road, but Kirk Ferentz's Hawkeyes having a down year.
Yeah, definitely having a down year. And also Michigan, you kind of touched on it there, partner. That's not going to be any easy task going to Columbus and facing a really hot Ohio State team.
Williams just stoned after a gain of two. Alonzo Whaley meeting Williams in the hole and bringing him down. Second down and eight. Nebraska playing Minnesota a year ago up in Minneapolis and winning. Trying to make it 16 wins in a row over the Gophers over the years. Williams, nice catch on that screen, trying to get to the edge, breaks a tackle. Ooh, and then is hit late. Are we going to see a flag? Yep, here it comes. They're going to get Damian Stafford for a hit out of bounds.
After the play was over, personal foul. Defense, number three, 15-yard penalty. Automatic first down.
Well, we know Damian Stafford is an aggressive style of safety, but you can see right at the last second, puts a hit on Roderick Williams. I know it's tough for a defensive back, their coach, to come downhill, make plays on the ball carriers, and it's so tough that when the guys get close to the sidelines, they're trying to pull off. Really close play right there from Damian Stafford.
One of the Husker cornerbacks, Andrew Green, helped off the field a moment ago, so Stanley Jean-Baptiste replaces him. He's number 16. Nelson wants to throw. Incomplete. It'll bring up second down. John, what do you have for us?
Well, you watch this Minnesota team, and they've battled through a lot last year after Jerry Kill took over. This year, they've had some obstacles overcome, and today, they're obviously down quite a bit, 31-0 right now. But as you watch Roderick Williams run, and you watch this offense play in the defense right now, they are not giving up at all. They are giving everything they have, and that's what Jerry Kill has been able to do, is get every ounce of playing time out of these guys.
Thanks, John. Yeah, that offensive line, you saw it last week, going through three different centers in their win against Illinois. It's been reshuffled. Zach Epping, who had started earlier in the year, is back to a starting role. But then two new additions. We haven't seen Ed Olsen or Tommy Olsen start in over a month. They both back into the lineup. So this is a group of five that really haven't had much time to gel together.
Yeah, you go with those Olsen brothers on the left side. They're really good football players, but there's still some rust on their game. They've got to be able to get their feet back underneath them. Merrick Lenkiewicz is actually in at the left tackle position right now, a guy that has actually started the past four games at left tackle.
Third down and seven. Deepest penetration of the day for the Gophers. Man is open and Gray can't make the catch. The senior Marquise Gray had a chance to make a big play, and he can't hang on. Damian Stafford made him pay the price, too.
And consecutive possessions now. We've seen Minnesota's had catchable balls they had just have not been able to bring in. Again, the ball's a little bit high, but Marquise Gray, that's a ball that you can catch. You know that you might take a hit, which he does from Damian Stafford, but you got to be able to bring that football in. It's a difference between keeping a drive alive or having your punt team come on the field.
I'm a little bit surprised that the Gophers are going to punt this away. End over end kick by Eldred, and it takes a big bounce into the end zone. It'll be a touchback. Ball at the 20-yard line. It's a punt of 38 yards, but a net of just 18. Nebraska ball when we come back. Nebraska this year, October 6th in Columbus against Ohio State. They give up 63 points and lose it. Afterwards, Bo Pelini with a big proclamation.
Like I just told the football team, we need to win out. We need to win out.
Well, I guess that's all it takes. They have won every game since, and it hasn't been easy. At Northwestern, against Michigan, at Michigan State, against Penn State. We're talking about running a gauntlet right there.
And you can see how his team has responded. They understood exactly the task at hand. And in a program like Nebraska, they compete for championships. So we get set back, but how do we get back to where we want to go? And we have to win out. That's exactly what this team has been able to do and in firm control here against Minnesota.
Opportunity for Braylon Hurd to get some playing time. He rushes forward for a couple of yards. Braylon Hurd shares the same hometown as that man, Bo Pelini. They both are from Youngstown, Ohio. Cardinal Mooney High School. Braylon Hurd was a big deal coming out of Northeast Ohio. Just a sophomore, Braylon Hurd came in same time as Amir Abdullah, and this year it's been Abdullah who's taken a big step forward, but Hurd's got a lot of talent as well. And off Hurd is brought down at the 21-yard line. Already today, a couple of significant milestones reached for Nebraska. Taylor Martinez becoming the all-time passing leader in terms of yards with the Cornhusker, passing Zach Taylor. Amir Abdullah going over 1,000 yards for the first time in his college career. He's just a sophomore. Third down and 9. Caught. What great hands close to the first down marker. Catch is made by Kenny Bell, and he took an absolute lick. Aaron Hill crushed him, but Bell able to hang on. They're going to give him the first down, but right now some concern. Kenny Bell down and in pain.
Yeah, extremely important to this team, but this has been the difference between Nebraska and Minnesota, is that Nebraska's made the tough catches when they needed to, and Kenny Bell, when he takes a hit, doesn't even bring the football back into his body, completely holds onto it.
I don't know.
Both hands. It looks like it might have come down, but I still think he had control of it. It was almost like he was palming the football on the way down.
Every play in college football is reviewed, some longer than others, but that's kind of interesting. Only getting a chance to look at it longer because of Bell being slow to get up. But that ball did hit the ground. 9 grabs, 136 yards. Both are career highs for Bell. Let's take one last look.
Yeah, see, what I was saying is that it almost looked like he just was palming the football in the one hand on the way down. It's tough to tell if it slipped out at the last second.
So it stands, 9 catches for Kenny Bell. Hand off to Abdullah. And he barrels forward to the 34-yard line. You're just joining us and wondering about Rex Burkhead. Been some thought that maybe he would play today. He is dressed and went through warm-ups, but just deciding no need to rush it. Burkhead dealing with that sprained knee virtually this entire season. Martinez keeps it and is brought down. Middle linebacker Rawlins with the tackle, no gain. Now more football coming your way throughout the Big Ten next Saturday. It's the final week of the regular season. First at noon, we've got the Land of Lincoln Trophy up for grabs. Illinois taking on Northwestern, or you'll see Indiana battling Purdue for the Old Oaken Bucket. Then at 3:30, these Minnesota Golden Gophers hosting Michigan State. It's next Saturday only on BTN. Third downs haven't really been a problem for Nebraska here in this second half. Martinez loses the football. That's going to be called a loose ball. And we've got a scrum. The Gophers say they have it. It stays with Nebraska. Nebraska has it, but it's going to bring up a fourth down, and the punt team will come on.
Good gamble there defensively pays off for the Gophers. They bring two linebackers in a blitz, Mike Rawlins and Aaron Hill. And Aaron Hill's the one that comes in and gets the hit on Martinez that lodges the football loose. Forces the fourth down for Nebraska.
So Maher's going to punt with the wind at his back. Gophers almost had it. High spiral. And Jones fields it on the run. Marcus Jones down the sideline. Tripped up at the 35-yard line.
Jones on return.
So the Gophers will have the ball trying to put their first points on the board. A 55-yard punt, 22-yard return. Take a look at the Rotel Campus rivalries. This is the 53rd meeting all time between Nebraska and Minnesota. And believe it or not, folks, but the series has been dominated by Minnesota. They've won 29 of the first 52. But a little bit closer look shows you that the last Minnesota win was way back in 1960. Since that time, Nebraska's won 15 in a row. But the overall series, handily, the Gophers are on top of the Cornhuskers. Majority of those games played in the early part of the 20th century. Were you familiar with that before you start getting ready for this game this week?
I was not. But I will tell you that from my experience at Minnesota that, yes, back in the early days and up to the 60s, Minnesota was a dominant program. So we definitely saw the banners when I was at school, albeit at the time they were 35, 40 years ago. They were there.
Nelson cut down as he tries to get to the 40-yard line. Should mention that in that 1960 season, which was the last time in which Minnesota defeated Nebraska. Oh, by the way, they went on to win the national championship. But Nebraska, they won 15 in a row in this series, and during that window, they are averaging 39 points per game against the Gophers. Minute and a half to play in the third quarter. Huskers bringing a blitz. It's picked up nicely by Minnesota. Loose ball. It is intercepted. Gene Baptiste got a chance for a touchdown. He's in. Touchdown, Nebraska. The deflected football and runs it in for a touchdown. Unofficially, we got a 48-yard interception return for a touchdown. The lead is 37-0, pending the extra point by Maher. Can you want from this black shirt defense of Nebraska? They have now scored 6 more points than they've given up on the afternoon. A pick 6, and they're still pitching a shutout against Minnesota.
Common theme here in the second half, dropped passes by Minnesota. Ball was a little bit behind Devin Crawford Tufts, but again, I think that's a ball that he should still be able to catch. It ricochets up in the air, and Gene Baptiste, again, opportunistic plays by this defense, making plays on the football, and he takes it all the way back for a pick 6.
Second interception on the year for Gene Baptiste, and his first touchdown. Minnesota here in this third quarter. It is not an easy proposition if you're an opposing quarterback taking on this Nebraska defense.
Well, I kind of mentioned that this defense has been coming into their own, and I'm talking about in Big Ten play. Look at how some of the opposing quarterbacks have fared against this Nebraska defense, and especially throwing the football. Teams just haven't had that element where they've been able to throw the ball down the field because of the pressure they've been providing up front. And then again in the secondary, the defensive backs and safeties have been making plays on the football, knocking it away and coming up with interceptions.
Nelson 7 of 19. That's about par for the course. Nebraska allowing opposing passers to complete 46% of their passes. That is best in the country. And it's actually even better than that in Big Ten conference games. Big Ten quarterbacks completing just 43% of their passes when they play Nebraska.
Opelini making it clear when he took over that he didn't feel the toughness was where he wanted this Nebraska defense to be at. It felt like, you know what, they were effective at times, but the toughness just wasn't there. This year, that's all changed. Quick pitch and catch. Frickte out across the 35, tackled by Joseph Carter.
Again, Eric, you talk about the toughness that needed to be instilled into this Nebraska defense. You just go back and look at some of the LSU defenses that he coordinated. Three of the defenses, 05, 6, and 7, finished number three in the country in total defense. That only happens when you have a tough defense that has depth. Guys are flying around, and you can see that's what he's building here in Nebraska. If you look at how deep they go in both the defensive line, linebackers, and in secondary.
Well, Minnesota not in any hurry to get another playoff going into the win. You know what? They're just tired of it all. They want to have the wind at their back and see if maybe that'll change things up. We've got the fourth quarter coming your way. It has been an impressive performance by these Nebraska Cornhuskers. They have dominated this one to the tune of a 38-0 lead heading into the fourth quarter. Flavor here in Lincoln when it comes to a football weekend. For my money, this could be the nicest place on earth. We've been here the last couple of days. Man, friendliest fans you're ever going to meet. It's just an event every time there's a football game involving the Huskers here at Memorial Stadium. Once again, another huge crowd, 85,000 plus. Another sellout, 50 straight years of sellouts here at Memorial Stadium.
The thing I would add to that is this is my first time here visiting Nebraska as well, and just outstanding facilities. I mean, probably the best I've ever seen in my time and being around college and professional sports. You go into their facility, and I mean, it is top-notch to the max when you look at meeting rooms, training room, weight room. Everything is top of the line.
Getting the fourth quarter, Gophers trying to get something going offensively. Nebraska pitching a shutout against them so far through the first game's 45 minutes. I haven't here in years past, and in the hotel in which I stayed at, Cornhusker fans were trying to learn the fight song of the visiting team that was in town so they could sing it along with the visiting fans just to make everyone feel comfortable. I was blown away when I saw that.
Don't think there's a whole lot of Michigan fans learning the Ohio State school songs and trying to.
Alonzo Whaley made the tackle, and he's also the guy who is being helped to the sideline. David Santos, number 41, redshirt freshman from Spring, Texas, replaces him. All right, here's a chance for Minnesota to do something they haven't done so far today. Let's pick up a first down on third down. Third down and two. They're 0-for-9 are the Gophers on third down so far this afternoon. Play action. Nelson wants to throw for it. Passes low and incomplete. Looking for Lincoln Plishek, and it's going to bring up fourth down and two. Busiest guy here in Lincoln has been the punter for Minnesota. Christian Eldreds had a workout. This is going to be his ninth punt. Fair catch called for and made by Jamal Turner. All right, how much more are we going to see out of Taylor Martinez? We'll find out if Taylor Martinez is going to be still in the game or if his backup, Ron Kellogg, will take over. Activity continues here in Lincoln. Well, on senior day, it's two underclassmen stealing the show as we take a look at today's Verizon Key Connection.
Seen a lot of these two connecting this afternoon. Kenny Bell, 136 receiving yards and a couple of touchdowns. And in fact, this is probably a statistic Minnesota doesn't want to hear, but Kenny Bell has more yards than Minnesota does.
Oof. I'd like to be up there, Rack.
don't think you could pay me enough to be up there.
That's actually a manned crane. There is a person inside there who I have no doubt is watching our game on BTN to go.
He's got his iPad up there?
Sure, why not? You need the replays. You need to hear the commentary. New quarterback coming on. How about this? Taylor Martinez, his day is done. Ron Kellogg III is going to come on. Hasn't played much at all on the year. Thrown just 5 passes, junior out of Omaha. Guy with a big-time pedigree. His dad played in the NBA for a while. Great basketball player.
Hasn't been on the field in a while. Played early on in the season against their non-conference opponents. But, you know, again, in these type of situations, it's good to be able to get your backup in the game, get him some game experience. But an excellent day from Taylor Martinez as far as decision-making, throwing the football, and running as well. Been a really solid day. And, again, can see why this Nebraska offense continues to put up so many points is the decisions that he's been making at the quarterback position.
Taylor Martinez, 4 times the Big Ten Player of the Week already this year. He's going to be in contention, but he may have to elbow out Kenny Bell. Kenny Bell has had such a terrific day that he may have a chance to take home that honor. Kellogg showing off a big arm. Pass is incomplete. Would have been enough for the first down, but it's dropped. You take a look at Taylor Martinez and the man behind him, Kenny Bell. You can identify him by his hair.
You think? I was going to see if you were going to try to pull off one of those.
There was a time in my life.
Good for television, right?
There was a time in my life I could have given a run for his money. Punt team comes on. Maher is going to kick into the wind. Bounces right on the end, right in the middle of the field, 50-yard line. Did it touch a gopher? Nope, it's going to be Minnesota ball. Cornhuskers are saying the ball hit a gopher and then they jumped on it. It should be their ball, but officials don't agree. It's a punt of just 25 yards for one of the best in the country in Brett Maher. So we'll take a quick timeout. We come back. Minnesota looking for their first points. BTN football is brought to you by State Farm. For auto, home, life, and banking, get to a better state. By Verizon, call Star NFL to get coverage of every NFL game on NFL Mobile from Verizon. And by Case IH. Be ready with Case IH Advanced Farming Systems. Visit KHIH.com/AFS. Now, Minnesota has wonderful starting field position, just trying to get something going against Bo Pelini's Nebraska defense. True freshman quarterback Philip Nelson still in the game. Been a tough afternoon for him. Roderick Williams with the handoff. That is true freshman handing off to true freshman. Joseph Carter makes the tackle. What makes this defense of Nebraska so good?
I think it starts up front with their defensive line. Their defensive line, especially today, has been doing an outstanding job of really standing up Minnesota's offensive line. So there's not any holes that are open. If you go back to Minnesota's game last week, there's a lot of holes that were open in the running game. Running backs were able to hit it with a full head of steam and get through the line of scrimmage. That just has not been the case today in the run game for the Gophers.
Nelson looking for the deep ball. Marquise Gray passes high and outside. We'll bring up third down. Now tonight, the third-ranked Gophers hit the home ice against arch-rival Wisconsin. That is tonight at 9 p.m. Eastern, presented by Buffalo Wild Wings. It has been at least a somewhat fulfilling weekend for Minnesota here in Lincoln. Yesterday, an absolute shocker. The women's volleyball team from Minnesota upsetting the women's volleyball team here in Nebraska. That'll bring a smile to Gopher fans, at least a little bit. Pass is high and incomplete, looking for the tight end, John Ray. Well, if for some reason the goal line was at the 35, Nebraska would still be pitching a shutout. Minnesota, they have not crossed the Nebraska 35-yard line all day long.
Okay. I was trying to figure out where you were going with that, but now I understand.
The passing numbers for Nelson have really taken a nosedive. Remember, the true freshman quarterback completed his first five passes on the day. He's three for his last 18, 16% in his last 18 throws. Fair catch called for and made by Turner. And Nebraska will have another possession with Ron Kellogg as the quarterback, not Taylor Martinez. They talk about the facilities, things happening here in Lincoln. This is Pinnacle Bank Arena. It's under construction. It's over just a couple blocks away in the Haymarket District. It's expected to be done in September of next year. It's going to seat approximately 16,000, 36 founder and executive suites. You got loges, 900 club seats. And of course, it is 2012. It's going to have an official Nebraska gear store. You can buy your team gear over at Pinnacle Bank Arena. The basketball teams are going to play there when that's completed.
So the facilities just continue to get better and better here for the Nebraska Cornhuskers. And that's what happens with success. When you're successful, you win games. Money continues to come in. You can continue to expand facilities. It's just one of those evolving processes that takes care of itself, and that brings in the recruits because they want to be a part of a winning tradition and they want to be around great facilities. And you can see why Nebraska continues to have success.
2 days ago, home game for Nebraska. They held on and defeated Valparaiso. So the basketball team feeling good about themselves with a recent win. So it's all going to come down to next week for Nebraska. They're not going to have as much time as normal to prepare for their next game. It's a Friday game. That's going to be a new tradition for Nebraska when they play Iowa. It's going to be the day after Thanksgiving. The game's going to be played in Iowa City. That's the game. If Nebraska wins, they don't care what Michigan does against Ohio State. Nebraska will punch their ticket to the Big Ten championship game. Complete. Kellogg showing off a good arm, but Kellogg can't make the catch. John, you got anything down there?
Yeah, you know, you watch this and you talk about championship teams and developing into a champion. Nebraska right now has improved on a week-to-week basis. They've improved throughout the season. And the thing that you got to really like about them is the fact that they have this senior leadership. They've been down double digits in four games, and they've made comebacks, and you gotta love that as they move forward into trying that for that Big Ten championship.
Hey, John.
Ball is loose on the field, and the Gophers able to jump on it. Jeremy Baltazar has the football, and it's gonna be Gopher football, even though that was in doubt for a moment.
Michael Carter trying to get the rest of the Gophers away. He's got to make that call a little bit sooner.
I think it actually hit Baltazar. Looked like a Husker had a chance for it, and Baltazar is the one who recovers it.
Hey, John, I got a question for you. You were part of some really good Michigan teams in the late 90s. What are some of the similarities that you're seeing being able to see Nebraska up close and personal today?
Well, one thing you like definitely about their season is the fact that when guys go down, they have other people step up and play just as well. When Rex Burkhead went down in week one, everybody said, well, what are we going to do at running back? Well, Amir Abdullah and a handful of other guys have stepped up and filled those roles, and that's what you need for championship football. And what I like about this Nebraska team.
Should mention there's a new quarterback now in for Minnesota, Max Shortell, who has some starting experience both this year and last. He replaces Philip Nelson. He is a sophomore from Shawnee Mission, Kansas. His first play in the game, rumbles for 14 yards. Are you surprised that Nelson has been replaced?
No, I think in this situation, again, you always want to make sure that your backup quarterback in the right opportunities is getting some snaps. He's always that one play away from being the starter.
That is the deepest penetration of the day. Andre McDonald with a back shoulder catch has the football inside the 20 for the Gophers.
Pick up of 26 yards.
Minnesota does it with their backup quarterback. James Gillum in a tailback. Haven't seen much of him in recent weeks. He's got the carry, and he gets forward to about the 16-yard line. Is this a step back for Minnesota as well as they've played in recent weeks, winning two of their last three?
You know, Eric, I'd probably say yes and no. Going on the road, facing one of the hotter teams in the conference, we knew was not going to be an easy task. And I'm sure Jerry Kill was telling his team it was not going to be an easy task. They would have had to play almost a perfect game and hope that Nebraska gave them a couple of extra opportunities. But this is also a situation where they go back, look at this tape, learn from the game, and then flush it out of their system and use it for next week.
Flag down. It's going to go against Nebraska. Charles Jackson was the defender on the coverage. And this is going to set the Gophers up nicely inside the 10.
Pass interference. Defense, number 27. The ball is placed at the 2-yard line. Automatic first down.
Again, Eric, you talked about it the first half, that Bo Pelini's not going to be too upset when he hears aggressive penalties. I'm not quite sure I would call that an aggressive penalty by Charles Jackson. I just think that was poor technique. Got himself in a bad situation with his technique and ended up grabbing the receiver to commit the penalty.
So the ball spotted at the 2-yard line. Fans would love a shutout, but that's definitely in doubt. First down and goal. Formation with a couple of tight ends. This is Gillum. Nowhere to go. Maybe gets a yard. Thad Randall meets him in the hole. We've got a Gopher down on the field. That is left tackle Merrick Lankiewicz. Lankiewicz has started about the last month and a half. This is an offensive line that for the most part hasn't been able to stay a full game healthy. And now the latest one to be down on the field is Lankiewicz.
Yeah, unfortunately, injuries just end up being part of the game. You just hope that they're minimal throughout the season and they don't happen to your very important positions. And for Minnesota, this has just been so tough for them to continue to be able to have success offensively when they've had so many injuries up front. Merrick Lankiewicz is doing a really good job of filling in. You can see kind of gets tripped up, number 74. It wasn't anything that he did wrong. It's just, again, when you get down by the goal line, there's so many bodies flying around, and Gophers just hate to continue to see offensive linemen go down with injuries.
Lankiewicz from the southwest suburbs of Chicago, from Tinley Park. This year, at times, Minnesota has had to play without Ed Olson, without Tommy Olson, without Zach Motla, without John Christensen. They've gone through three centers.
Now, their right tackle, Eric, Josh Campion, number 65, is the only offensive lineman to start every game this year at the same position. So many other guys, left tackle, left guard, center, and right guard, have all had different starters throughout the season.
Marquise Gray now in the game at the tailback spot. Now he's going to get the direct snap. This is Gray. Big fella runs it in. Gray beginning the season as the starting quarterback, getting an opportunity there in the Wildcat, and runs it in. So the Gophers are on the board.
May have been the best push that they've got up front in the running game the entire night. Of course, Nebraska not quite sure what was going to be thrown at them with Marquise Gray lined up in the Wildcat. Haven't been shown that on film in the past.
Wettstein will come on. So the Gophers score for the first time. It comes in the midway point of our fourth quarter. The senior, Marquise Gray, runs it in from a yard out. Well, as you know, the Northeast has been hit hard with Superstorm Sandy, and the people in this region, they need a lot of help during the Thanksgiving season. Keep these people in your thoughts by visiting redcross.org to see how you can help.
People from all over the country lending a helping hand. Indiana's Veteran Energy Group came all the way out to Long Island to support, lend a hand, help people restore lights. It's great to see people all over the country helping out in a time of need.
Into the back of Wettstein, and he kicks it off the crossbar. Almost made that. With the wind at the back, man, ball just flying. 7:39 left to play. This is going to be the third offensive series for Taylor Martinez's backup, Ron Kellogg. I don't think you're allowed to leave if you come to Memorial Stadium.
Telling you.
They sell out 50 consecutive years. And even in a game in which it's 38-7, this place is still almost totally filled. Where else would you rather be, I guess? Huh? Kellogg hands it off. Gain of two. Monty Cross getting a chance to run from scrimmage. This is normally the guy who's been the goal line running back. Getting a chance right now to get things going. More of an open field situation. Been a tough connection. Third time that Kellogg has thrown it in the direction of Jake Long, and it's the third time it's been incomplete. Rex Burkhead still on the sideline, warmed up today. We thought we'd get a chance to see him, but he hasn't gotten on the field to play. This is a guy over 3,000 career yards, hasn't had much of a senior season, just 405 yards and 47 carries. But what a terrific senior he has been for Bo Pelini and these Cornhuskers.
He still had that helmet on too, Eric. Like he was going to come into the ballgame. You know he wanted to play senior day, final game here at Memorial Stadium, but also thinking that there's still quite a bit of season left. Want to make sure that he gets 100% before he comes back out on the field.
Personal foul. Chop block. Offense. Half the distance of the goal line. Third down.
As well as Nebraska has played for the first three quarters of this one, this fourth quarter has not been a work of art. The offense has really struggled with the backup quarterback in, now dealing with penalties.
Yeah, a lot of times it ends up being a struggle when you get the second unit. Haven't had a whole lot of time working together. And they're trying to put together a couple of first downs. Obviously, coaches, Bo Pelini doesn't like to see this, but
low kick into the wind. It's going to be picked up on the run by Michael Carter, who's tackled at the 32-yard line. Let's talk about next week. Nebraska, they're going to head up on Friday, or head up on Thursday, and take on Iowa. It's going to be a Friday game. How do you think Nebraska matches up with Iowa at home? Iowa, of course, not having a great year, but they are playing at home.
Yeah, extremely well. I mean, there's not a whole lot of weaknesses. Again, I go back to the fact that when Nebraska does not turn the football over, they're going to be an extremely tough team to beat because they've got so many weapons. I mean, we got a chance to see him today. Taylor Martinez, Amir Abdullah, Kenny Bell, assuming he continues to be healthy. Now they're bringing Imani Cross in the ballgame for short yardage and goal line situations.
Late flag comes in. May have been a bit of theatrics there. Caleb Bach had a late push on a Cornhusker. I have a feeling this is going to go against Minnesota.
After the play was over, personal foul. Defense, number 12.
Oh.
Personal foul. Offense, number 64. Penalties offset. Second down.
Yeah, I think Courtney Osborne was the instigator. And what the fans here at Memorial Stadium saw was the retaliation of Caleb Bach.
Yeah, watch
number 12. He 12 pushes Bach in the back. Oh!
You know, they usually say that the second guy is the one that's always called. So give the officials credit that they did get the first guy in that situation as well.
It's one of the rules of Jerry Kill, personal foul, you got to come out. So Bach is on the sideline, replaced by Joe Bjorklund. Shortell going deep, no flag on that one. This season has been a success for the Gophers. They won a week ago in Champaign against Illinois. For their sixth win, they're now bowl eligible for the first time in 3 years.
You know, again, it's a growing process. It's a rebuilding process going on with Minnesota. And these are the type of steps that you have to take as far as getting yourself to bowl eligible, getting six wins so you can play in the postseason, get extra practices for your young players.
It's going to be close to the first down marker. Devin Crawford Tufts with the catch. Tackle made by Mohamed Cisse.
You know, I talked about extra practices for the young players, but it's also it's a lot of seniors on the team for Minnesota as well that have been through a lot in their football careers. Coaching changes, haven't seen a whole lot of success, especially in Big Ten conference play. So it's a good celebration for them to be able to play in the postseason where, look at the last couple of years, they've had to watch teams from their couches in December and January.
Derek, what we just saw a moment ago, that was the first third down conversion allowed by this Nebraska Cornhusker defense. The first 11 third downs attempted to be converted by Minnesota, all of them were foiled by Nebraska. How about this? Tomorrow night, Tubby Smith's Golden Gophers taking on the Richmond Spiders. That's up at the Barn Williams Arena. That's a men's basketball showdown starting at 7 Eastern time. That's tomorrow, only on BTN. And don't go to sleep on those Spiders. Chris Mooney's Richmond Spiders, they are a good team. They've been perennially in the NCAA tournament. They could give Minnesota a real test. Shortell wants a bunch, has a man open. Crawford Tufts had a step or two, but the pass is too strong. Rack, I don't know how closely you're paying attention to Minnesota basketball, but Trevor Mbakwe blew out his knee a year ago. He is back healthy, and this guy,
man-child,
maybe the fiercest man in the conference.
Man-child. I tell you, he's the guy I want on my team. Strong, physical, just moves people out of the way, getting rebounds. Obviously, they need him to be healthy. They need him to play well this year. Minnesota could be another one of those teams that jumps up and surprises people again, especially if Mbakwe has a productive season like most people expect.
Shortell escapes the first wave, passes high and incomplete. So it's fourth down, and the offense will stay on the field. There's a flag down.
Personal foul, tripping, offense, number 52. Penalties declined, fourth down.
Zach Epping, the center, called for tripping. So the Gophers deciding to punt on fourth down. Over on the 9 yard line after that 44 yard punt by Eldred. Let's take a look at our John Deere Gator game changer, and this is kind of outside the box for us, but we're going to give it to the retiring Tom Osborne.
Yeah, very fitting today. How much he has meant to this program over the years, how long he has been a part of this program. And again, we talk so much about Nebraska, their history of winning. And most of it starts with Tom Osborne and the role he has played here, creating a football powerhouse for the Cornhuskers.
It's been amazing throughout the course of this game. They've had video tributes and people come on the scoreboard, mention how Tom Osborne has changed their life or influenced their life. And for the most part, 85,000 fans here at Memorial Stadium, you would have thought we were inside the campus library. It has been so quiet, people just wrapped in attention and in paying homage to Tom Osborne.
Oh, it's unbelievable.
What he has done here.
I mean, there's been so many of those video tributes throughout the game today, and every time one comes on, the crowd base here just quiets and everybody in the stands is listening. And afterwards, they're clapping for the words that are being said about Coach.
Kind of an unusual play there. The ball is dropped in the backfield, picked up, and a gain of two.
Ron Kellogg now his third series as the quarterback of the Cornhuskers. We've got an injured Gopher. That's Brandon Beal. Beal is down and being looked at now by the Gopher training staff. This is a guy, so much talent, big ballyhooed recruit. He was one of the most well-known high school players in the country coming out of Bangor, Pennsylvania. Went down to Florida, was a huge recruit for Urban Meyer. Never really got a chance to play because of consistent knee injuries. Decided to transfer and finish off his college career with the Gophers. And just right now, not the same player he was as a high school player because of consistently getting banged up as a college player. So Beal leaves. And it'll be third down and eight. On the field, and Alex Keith, big old number 91, true freshman from Columbia, Maryland, jumps on the loose football, and the Gophers point blank position right here, first down at 10.
Yeah, Ron Kellogg just stays on this read a little bit too long. In this point in the ball game, you just have to go ahead and make a decision. Either you're going to give it to the running back Braylon Hurd, or you're going to pull it out and keep it. You just can't prolong it in this situation where guys just haven't worked on that exchange throughout the season together.
Derek, you talked about it earlier in the game. Nebraska, one of the things they don't do well is they consistently turn the football over.
Yeah, we talked to Coach Pelini about that, and he said, you know, I understand the way that we play offense as far as how they run the ball with the zone read, that every once in a while there's going to be a ball on the ground. They just can't afford to do it the rest of the season.
Second touchdown for Marquise Gray out of that Wildcat formation. The senior Gray started the season as the starting quarterback for the Gophers. Just so injured, they had to move to a wide receiver. Now getting a chance here in the fourth quarter to show how dynamic he can be. A couple of rushing touchdowns.
Yeah, I think a lot of people figured that there might be this wrinkle thrown into the offense with Gray still trying to use him in a wildcat or put him in motion and get the ball in his hands. But the coaching staff saying, you know, frankly, we got to get him 100% before we start getting really creative with how we factor him into the offense.
So the first three quarters for Minnesota, there's a whole bunch of nothing going on. Just couldn't get the offense in gear at all. But in the fourth quarter, a couple of turnovers, and the offense finally showing some life, led by Marquise Gray. Touchdowns in the last 4 minutes and 40 seconds for Marquise Gray. Just a reminder, after the game, the Final Drive brings you all the highlights from this game and around the entire Big Ten. Final Drive tonight, right after our game on BTN. Derek, now that we've made it through 57 minutes of this one, how big of a factor in your mind has the win been?
It really hasn't been a big factor. We talked about it the first half with Brent Maher and what he's been able to do, especially when he was going into the win. A couple of big-time kicks. And then Taylor Martinez, he had that one long throw early in the game and didn't seem to bother him a whole lot.
Jamal Turner with a nice return out to the 35-yard line. Yeah, the final numbers for the starting quarterback for Minnesota, Philip Nelson. He goes 8 for 23, 59 yards, a couple of interceptions. You're saying that wasn't the win, that was just the blackshirt defense?
I think that was the blackshirt defense. That was also a quarterback that wasn't throwing the football his best. And I think we talked about it, too, in the second half. That was receivers that didn't help him out. Too many dropped passes that could have continued drives where the guys just, frankly, had the ball in their hands and they couldn't bring it in.
A learning experience if nothing else, for Philip Nelson. They think he's got a chance to be their guy over the next handful of years. New quarterback is no longer Ron Kellogg. So this is now the third quarterback we're going to see for Nebraska. Bronson Marsh. This is his first playing time of the season. Redshirt freshman out of Omaha is Bronson Marsh. I don't think that Bo Pelini wanted to go to his third stringer. I just think that Ron Kellogg wasn't doing what the coaching staff wanted.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I don't think he was happy with the way that Kellogg was orchestrating the offense, especially with that turnover back inside the 10-yard line.
Marsh, not a big guy, 6 feet tall, 195 pounds. Under 100 seconds left to play in this one. It has been all Nebraska. A couple of fourth quarter touchdowns for Minnesota. Both of them runs by Marquise Gray. Neither team has used a timeout here in the second half. That's going to be a first down for Nebraska. And off comes the headset for Bo Pelini. So, 9 wins for the fifth consecutive year for Bo Pelini here in Lincoln. And it hasn't been easy. Man, they have played, in my opinion, the most difficult schedule around the conference. Wisconsin, Ohio State, Northwestern, Michigan, Michigan State on the road, Penn State, and just one conference loss, they're going to move to 6-1. And Tom Osborne, I think, believes this one is in the books. The 500th game in which he is involved with this football program at Nebraska is going to be a win. Cornhuskers score the game's first 38 points and win it going away, 38-14 over Minnesota.
Again, impressive performance all three phases of the game for Nebraska. Got a little sloppy towards the end of the ball game, maybe a little bit to be expected having your second and third string players in there. But I think when you saw the starters in the game, you saw the reason why they've caught this run and how Coach Pelini said, we got to win out. And his players are responding, and they're doing just that.
In the 500th game for Tom Osborne, the offense celebrates by racking up 444 total yards. Kenny Bell was terrific, got a little bit nicked up late in the game. There's going to be some talk making sure he is ready to go on Friday when they take on the Iowa Hawkeyes. But a lot to like if you're a Cornhusker fan. Taylor Martinez doing it through the air. The passing game was terrific to both Kenny Bell and Jamal Turner. And the final score, 38-14, Cornhuskers. Coming up, it's the final drive with Dave and the gang from our Chicago studios. So for Derek Brackley and John Jansen, I'm Eric Collins saying so long, everybody, from Nebraska.